again, everybody. Our first panel that we have up here are all from federal agencies that are serving as partners to our collective effort to clean up the Chesapeake Bay watershed. The first person you will hear from is Rich Batiuk, who has been with the Environmental Protection Agency for 31 years and currently is in their Chesapeake Bay program office in Annapolis. Rich's focus now is on making sure that our local partners have the resources and the understanding of how they play a role in the Chesapeake Bay watershed cleanup efforts and also local watershed cleanup efforts. So with that, I'd like to call up Rich, and we will be doing questions on cards at the end for the entire panel.
Good morning. So Sunday night, we flew back from a week's vacation out in the Puget Sound area, hiking up in the Cascades. I can tell you, water quality was a little clearer up there, but I can tell you, it was great to be home because their version of crab cakes includes a thing called a Dungeness crab. Doesn't taste anything like a good Choptank crab. So they may have a little clearer water out there. We've got tastier crabs out there, and I'll match them up any day to that as well. So what I wanted to do is I'm not going to correct everything Tom Fisher said, but I may add a little bit of color to his commentary. I want to give you a sense of our best estimates for the loads coming in from the watershed itself, based on a combination of monitoring data and model outputs, and then put it in the context of what we hope to provide to you all in the next year to 2 years as the partnership, all six states, EPA partners, our federal partners, district partners, Chesapeake Bay Commission, and others across the watershed are looking at halfway through the Chesapeake Bay TMDL, our wonderful Bay Pollution Diet, how are we doing, and are we going to get there by 2025, and what else do we need to do? So you're right, the picture for the Choptank is not clear, it's getting clearer, and we think over the next 2 years we're going to get better and better understanding about what's working, what's not, and what additional actions we have to take over time as well. But what we want to do is to start to walk you through this. We're fortunate in the Bay region here to have not only almost 25, 30 years worth of monitoring. So for 3+ decades, we've been watching the Choptank, the river at Greensboro, but we've also been modeling it. Models are only as good as the science that we have in there, but we've been fortunate to have 3 decades worth of understanding what's coming in from the air, what's coming off of our watersheds, what's coming into the estuary itself, and how does that influence habitat for crabs, oysters, underwater grasses, etc. So I'm going to put up 3 graphics here. In this case, this is a combination in blue. This is the USGS gauging station at Greensboro. So this is our direct measure. Very little of the Choptank actually has free-flowing river where we can put a monitor in place. We're fortunate. It's got a tremendous amount of tidally influenced waters out there, but that makes it more difficult to monitor. So what we need to do then in the orange portion of the bars here, that's is our estimate using the partnership's phase 532 model of, given how much farm fields we have out there, agriculture areas, suburban, urban areas, here's our estimate for each of those years, given the practices on place, given the rainfall patterns, here's what likely the river is seeing from that. And then the little gray section at the top, that's for those point source discharges in Cambridge, Denton, and others that directly discharge into the river itself through the state. We're able to monitor those directly and understand it as well. So as Tom was showing, we're seeing a lot of influence still from rainfall patterns out there. We haven't sort of broken that rainfall pattern that every time it rains, we're going to get runoff from our farm fields, from our forest areas, from our urban, suburban neighborhoods as well out there. So one of the things that we're going to continue to do, you're going to hear a little bit from Joel, in a little while, in the next 6 months or so, we're also going to bring where we're trying to, not only for the free-flowing rivers, but in the estuary itself, to try to correct for, to pull out the signal of not only rainfall, but also tidal cycles, because we need to pull out sort of that natural signal so that not only you're seeing this up and down here, you're seeing what the influence of us humans on the land are. Not there quite yet, but we're working towards that as well. But again, Bobby and others, why you're not seeing a real clear pattern out there is every time it rains out there, we're seeing in some cases even more nitrogen getting into the system than less. We're starting to see, as Tom indicated, not only in the Choptank, but in watersheds across the entire Chesapeake Bay watershed, clear signals that things are happening out there, they're responding. The Choptank signal is not as clear as we'd like to see it, but I think as you hear panel members this morning and this afternoon, we'll get a better picture. In the case of phosphorus, again, same thing. USGS gauging station, that's coming in at Greensboro. In the orange, that's for the tidally influenced sections of the Choptank. And you can see in the gray bars as you go over time, Towns, cities, and state of Maryland have made great progress in reducing the amount of phosphorus coming out of the wastewater treatment plants out here. But you'll also notice a signal. Not only are wonderful hurricanes, I have to talk to my USGS partners. They always talk about 100-year storms. I'm not as old as Walt Boynton in there. Well, Walt's been around for a while, but I think I've experienced in my 30-plus years in the Chesapeake Bay watershed several, maybe 400 or 500-year storms. Something's not right out there. We are seeing more intensive storms out there. We've got to figure out how to do that, and our Choptank watershed is showing that, particularly in the last decade or so. Again, we're starting to develop techniques with our USGS partners, University of Maryland Center for Environmental Sciences, to pull out that effect of rainfall, the effect of tide, and hopefully as we continue to work with you all in the next year or two, we'll bring that information to the table. In a similar kind of picture in this case, our best estimates of what the Choptank estuary, in all its creeks and rivers, which makes it so unique out there, it's those little small creeks and tidal areas. Talking to the folks out in Puget Sound, they got, you know, this deep, I call it a deep bathtub out there. They don't have all those nooks and crannies. That's what makes the Chesapeake so productive. That's what makes it so unique for our watermen out there, for those of us that enjoy the recreational opportunities. And that's what makes it so responsive to what's happening on the land. In this case, our sediment getting into the system is responding to those rain events out there as well. Again, we're starting to, as Tom showed you, we're starting to see that signal where those practices, particularly for phosphorus and sediment, are making a difference. Bobby, you mentioned sort of the memory of the system. Yeah, we've seen that, and Joel, I think we'll talk about that a little bit more in terms of in the groundwater as well. Another piece of data that we've got, and this is strictly from model. This is from the partnership's fifth version of our model since the 1970s, where we take the accumulated science and understanding. We also try to do something that is not done anywhere across a six-state watershed, and that is to capture the practices. The 40-plus that you showed up here that the dean and Bobby showed there as well, plus others that are happening out there, working through Maryland Department of Ag, Jason Kepler and his staff in the conservation districts, and you'll hear this afternoon, and then capture those and apply them. They are reducing nitrogen, phosphorus, and sediment. They're attenuating it. They're preventing excess nutrients that are not being uptaken by crops or by silviculture out there. So what we're looking at is from 1985, sort of the start time for the partnership, working on bay restoration, then annually from 2009 to 15, and then where we're trying to head in terms of the Choptank, where we think our current best science indicates we get there, we should have underwater grasses out there, we should have good dissolved oxygen, we should have the right level of algae that we're seeing in a particular system. So you're seeing certainly some downward trends from 1985, a little flattening up, a little bump in 2014, 2015. That was bringing in new data from the Ag Census in terms of what we think might have been some cropping patterns because of price of corn, et cetera. So we've got a good pattern, but we also got still a steep climb to get from 2015 to where we're asking Maryland and Delaware and Virginia here on the Delmarva to get there by 2025 as well. So clearly, progress has been made out there, but we've got some challenges to move forward. And phosphorus, you can see that orange section, large decreases in terms of wastewater treatment upgrades to 2015. And then the blue bars are reflecting the non-point source practices, mainly in the agricultural sector, a little bit in the forestry sector as well. Again, a little flatter than we'd like, and then where we're trying to head towards 2025 as well. And then sediment, again, our best estimates from that, again, a decrease from 85 to where we are, a slight decrease over the last 4 to 5 years, and then where we need to continue to jump there as well. One of the things that this does not reflect, and that is new science that we have coming in there, phosphorus-saturated soils, working again with Jason and his team and the conservation districts to get a better understanding of the history of practices out there, better understanding of the groundwater with our USGS scientists as well. So we're going to continue to improve the type of information we have coming forward. But one of the things our information does tell us, and that is you might have heard some folks talking about Conowingo and trying to blame what's happening here on the Eastern Shore, and particularly in the Choptank on Conowingo. I can tell you, this information takes essentially what we understand, how not only the watershed works, but how the estuary works. So think of this as a large dye study. In other words, for each of the major river systems here, we essentially mathematically, through our collective set of understanding of both the watershed and the estuary, said, hey, listen, if we turned off every other watershed other than the Choptank, and we put nitrogen that might have been as a part of a dye study, how much of that influenced local water quality conditions in the Choptank compared to if you turned to everyone else and just ran the Susquehanna and said, okay, how much does it influence on the Choptank? So what it essentially says, pound for pound, a reduction of a pound of nitrogen in the Choptank has a 16 times more, or 8 times more influence on local Choptank waters than the Susquehanna. Are you going to get there without the Susquehanna's help in New York and Pennsylvania? No. Do you need help from others along the eastern and western shore? Most definitely. But the majority of what you're seeing in the Choptank, if there's no salt in it, it's your problem. If you've got a little bit of to medium amount of salt, it's still a very much a localized problem. Yes, again, your neighbors to the north and south, your upstream and downstream tidal areas do have an influence. But a lot of what happens in the Choptank is more in your own system itself as well. So folks that say if you solve Conowingo, you solve Choptank, you help a bit, but we've really got to work in our own watershed here in order to make that happen. So one of the things we're doing is a part of the partnership is to continue to improve that science and understanding out there. And one of the places we're doing, for the first time, 64,000 square miles across six states, we've got a mapping of all the land uses, land cover, at a 1 meter resolution. Now some might say, wait a second, is that a privacy issue? Sorry, if you go on Google Maps, you can see into my backyard and you can see what color car my wife drives in my parking lot. What this information does is it goes from where we've worked for the past 20 years. If you see in this sort of blurry image, let's look over here first. So this is in the rural areas to this is the imagery we're looking at now. We're not trying to get individual farms or any individual practices, but where those forested areas along streams, where we've got different cropping patterns, where people's yards are, where those roads are. Look about the information, and when you're looking at an urban, suburban area in Cambridge, from something like that to that, makes a lot of difference. This is just one of the improvements that the partnership's bringing to understand how far we've come in the last 30 plus years, how are we gonna get to 2025, how do we get there smart, how do we give credit to our producers, to our towns, to our cities that have done good work out there, and how do we focus our dollars on the place that's going to make the most difference for our local streams, our rivers, our embayments, our crabs out there as well. So I think we've got a good science to do that. We're also looking at our models and our understanding so that in the next year, you won't need a PhD and a pocket protector to understand it. So that we need to, in fact, be able to say, what is the average load coming into the Choptank? What are the soils out there? How that rainfall is influencing it? We know the land areas. We know your BMPs. Both your cost share and then working again with Jason and his team on voluntary ones. We understand what travels to the water, through the streams and through the rivers. Very simply put, and then we can go back and diagnose that and say, what areas are those in parts of the Choptank that we think we've got practices? Let's look at the monitoring data. What's not responding in there? Very simply put it through there as well. So again, I can tell you, when that 2015 came around there, not just water clarity, we, for the first time, we've seen dissolved oxygen in the main stem of the Chesapeake. The deepest part of that mine with the deepest canary down there was starting to say, I'm responding. Grasses hit their record in the past 35 years in 2015 as well. Wasn't a fluke, wasn't a whole bunch of dry conditions out there. Collectively, that system is responding. We don't see that signal as clear in the Choptank as we'd like to. There's pieces of it that we want to pull out, like the groundwater saturated areas, phosphorus saturated soils. But we are seeing most definitely signs across the entire watershed that your individual work and others is in fact paying off. But here in the Choptank, you're responsible for most of those conditions in that estuary itself. So we've got to do most of the work here. We've got to continue to give credit for those practices. We've got to understand the delay and what's happening out there. And we've got to continue to factor that in to get smarter about what we need to do then. Thank you.
Next, we're going to hear from Joel Blomquist with U.S. Geological Survey. Mr. Blomquist serves as a water quality team leader for the USGS Chesapeake Bay Science Team and leader of the Maryland River Input Monitoring Program.
Okay. Thanks for having me down here today. Really appreciate the opportunity. So today, I'll be going through a presentation that was prepared by my colleagues, Scott Ator and Judy Denver. Many of you have heard them speak at other occasions. I'll be going through a fairly detailed synthesis work that brought together science from over 130 different published reports and data series that covered the Eastern Shore area. And so my goal today is to kind of summarize and bring those results to you so that you can understand how the Choptank River system works using the Eastern Shore results as a backdrop, and then understand what the trends are in nutrient and sediment loads in the watershed, and what are those controlling features, so we can start to really understand if we're going in the direction we want to and how long it's going to take to get there. So this could easily have been a semester-long discussion in a course, or an hour-long discussion, so I have the challenge of bringing this to you in about 15 minutes. So I think I'll try to be able to make it. So our outline is to go through sources of nitrogen and phosphorus to landscape in this region, understand how nitrogen and phosphorus moves through the system, because that's very important in understanding where we're going in the long run in terms of restoration activities. Explain some of the things that deal with the trends that we've observed in groundwater and streams, and talk about response times and management implications. And then I'll end by kind of reinforcing what you saw with Tom in terms of the long-term loads and our recent findings. So the first thing to know about the watershed, and I think Rich has gone through this too, is that the Eastern Shore has a disproportionate amount of nitrogen and phosphorus imports to the land relative to the entire Chesapeake Bay watershed. So the Eastern Shore isn't the only hotspot. There are several of these regional hotspots spread across the Chesapeake watershed that are consistent with developed lands and highly productive agricultural lands. And so you'll see that nitrogen and phosphorus sources to the watershed are about double the average of the entire Chesapeake Bay watershed. And so what we're dealing with in terms of trends in the watershed is a long-term history of inputs. And so what I have shown here on the graph are really the fertilizer use histories. And you'll see in blue, since 1950, we had a fairly steep increase in the amount of nitrogen inputs, and they've stabilized since the late 1970s, early 80s. And then we had a steep increase of phosphorus fertilizer inputs, followed by the realization that we had accreted a lot of phosphorus in soil, and so we've diminished the amount of phosphorus input. And so on the Eastern Shore, all these inputs are coincident with a 100-fold increase in poultry production. So much of that fertilizer is serving to produce grain for feed for the poultry industry. And so this graph shows the amount of excess nitrogen and phosphorus fertilizer that was put on the land for the period 1940 through 2010. And so if you look at the bottom, that zero line is where you're adding exactly the amount of nitrogen and phosphorus to the land that the crops require. And so you'll see that we are consistently 20 pounds of phosphorus per acre greater than the crop requirement in the early 1950s and 1960s, and we've gone down to close to 10 to 12 pounds per acre for phosphorus, but we're still adding more phosphorus to land on whole than the crops require. And nitrogen similar, we peaked at about 70 pounds per acre more on whole than crops require. And so in terms of what we need to do is we need to really bring that excess nitrogen and phosphorus applications to the land much closer to that zero line. So how does nitrogen and phosphorus move through the watershed? So this graph shows the observed phosphorus concentrations relative to the observed stream flow characteristics or stream flow amounts at a local watershed up at Chesterville Branch near Crumpton. And so it shows suspended sediment in red, phosphorus in blue, and nitrogen in black. And so really what this shows is that sediment and phosphorus are driven by stream flow. It's increasing. It means the energy of flow washes soil and associated phosphorus off the land. So that's the primary vector for sediment and phosphorus. Whereas the nitrate, you'll see a real dilution signal. At higher flows, you have lower nitrate concentrations. That's indicating that groundwater is the largest vector for moving nitrogen through the system. So these are really important for understanding how what drives the trends that we observe across the watershed. So knowing that nitrogen is groundwater is a major vector for nitrogen, we have to understand that nitrate moves through groundwater in short and long flow paths. Some can be as short as 1 to 2 years, others can be take a much longer time period. And so we know that denitrification is one of the saviors of our ecosystem in that it takes the excess nitrogen and can reduce it to nitrogen gas, which is eventually lost to the atmosphere. So much of what we have done is tried to route nitrogen through the groundwater systems in an attempt to increase this denitrification through the watershed. Now, nitrogen denitrification does not occur everywhere consistently across the watershed, but it is a factor that predominates in the Choptank River watershed. So as you saw from Tom's results, we had smaller concentrations of nitrogen in the Choptank than elsewhere. We'll just kind of speed up and show that there's several conditions where we have high organic matter that induces nitrate denitrification. And so when we look at groundwater data, we can see that when you have zero oxygen in the system, that's where you're consuming the nitrate, and when you have when you have plentiful oxygen, you do not have denitrification. So groundwater transport can vary from less than 10 years to up to 50 years across the watershed, with the shorter flow paths occurring in the headwaters in areas right close to streams. So across the watershed, we have transport that goes up to, on average, 20 years or 30 years that it takes for nitrogen to move all the way through the system. I'm just going to skip and try to make it through. So what we see here is when we look at groundwater nitrogen data in shallow wells, we're currently seeing that the nitrogen that we're seeing in the groundwater is responding to earlier periods in history of nitrogen applications. So you can see the two periods here where later in the curve of nitrogen applications, we're seeing higher groundwater levels of nitrate. And so this is then reflected in the long-term trends of nitrogen we see. Also, we're seeing that for phosphorus, we see increasing trends during the last more recent periods of orthophosphorus and total phosphorus levels, which is also consistent with some increasing, which is uncharacteristically coincident with decreasing trends in suspended sediment concentrations. So this is indicating to us that we have soil saturation or perhaps higher amounts of phosphorus bound to sediment in the system, or then a release of dissolved sediment phosphorus from those sediments. So what do we know about response times? We know from work from Ken Staver and others that management practices that limit nitrogen infiltrating through shallow groundwater work. So you see on the top graph, conventional till versus no-till. When you're using cover crops, we see a decline in the nitrogen concentrations underneath those agricultural fields. But it may take decades for those responses we see underneath those agricultural fields to respond in terms of loads and trends. And so from groundwater modeling work, we see that a 13% reduction in the nitrogen load will be required just to maintain status quo. And then if we get a 40% reduction in loads to groundwater, it will not cause a 25% reduction in loads to the bay until at least 2050. So a very quick look at some of the new data, and this will kind of complement what we see from Tom Fisher. We take our monitoring data, you see a lot of dots from samples. We take our stream flow data, and we can estimate a load or flux to the estuary, which is highly dependent on stream flow. We have a technique to remove that effect of stream flow and develop what we call flow normalized flux. And so these are very similar and complementary, but they're in different units than what you saw from Tom Fisher. These are in units of mass loading. So it removes that interannual variability, and it's in the units that we're really trying to decrease going to Chesapeake Bay. And so what we see here is nitrogen, in terms of the total nitrogen and the nitrate nitrogen, are increasing, as well as the total phosphorus and dissolved orthophosphate. We see that the total nitrogen and the total phosphorus have declined in the early periods of restoration in 1985 for about a decade. So this may be due to some of those conservation practices that were originally put in place that kind of redirected the vectors of that nitrogen and phosphorus. But now we're still dealing with that long-term history of nitrogen in the groundwater systems and the phosphorus and dissolved accumulating in the soil. So just to summarize, we know that the eastern shore contributes a disproportionately large load of nitrogen phosphorus to Chesapeake Bay. We know that the nutrient loads from the eastern shore continue to increase, and this increase is due to the long history of application in excess of crop requirements, and it'll take some time for it to move through the groundwater and soils. And even if the current management practices are effective in limiting nutrients to the landscape, the movement through the water and the soil systems will require considerable time and effort before we see full reductions to Chesapeake Bay.
Our third speaker on the federal panel is Bruce Vogt with the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. At NOAA, Mr. Vogt is an ecosystem science and synthesis manager, and in that role manages ecosystem science and habitat assessment activities.
I'm Bruce Vogt. I appreciate you all having me here today to talk a little bit about what NOAA is doing in the Choptank. Listening to all the presentations earlier today, you know, you've heard a lot about phosphorus and nitrogen loading. We're gonna flip things a little bit. How many of you like to fish? Number of folks here? How many people like oysters? All right, we got a number of you in the crowd. So we're gonna shift your thinking now. Put yourself in the position of an oyster. You're sitting there on the bottom, you're growing on a reef, and everything that's happening on land with respect to nitrogen and phosphorus is coming downstream and flowing over you, and you can't move. You're stuck, right? I mean, you got it. That's your home. You got to deal with what's coming over you. You have options. You can try to adapt and deal with those stressors, or you die. We're trying to avoid that last part, so I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what's going on with respect to oyster restoration. I want you to, you know, sort of put yourself in the position of an oyster and think about how we can, you know, better improve those water quality trends you saw in a way that are going to allow for oysters to thrive, for fish to thrive, and ultimately for all of you who said you like to go fishing or liked oysters to have the opportunity to continue to go fishing in this watershed and continue to enjoy oysters. First, I'm going to give you a little bit of an overview, though. NOAA is here in the Choptank because of something called habitat focus areas. About 5 years ago, NOAA started what was called the Habitat Blueprint. Some of you might recognize the name Eric Schwab. He was here at Maryland Department of Natural Resources for a while and then came over to NOAA. He was really interested in trying to improve NOAA's focus on habitat. So he asked that we come up with a plan that was called the Habitat Blueprint. Since that time, like I said, over the last 5 years, NOAA selected 10 habitat focus areas. And the habitat focus area is really just trying to better target our habitat activities in a couple of smaller geographic areas. And so 10 of those have been selected across the nation and in territories, all the way from Guam to the Choptank. It's also important to note here before I get started that everything I'm going to talk about is heavily reliant upon partnerships. In particular, the Maryland Department of Natural Resources, the areas where we're working is either state land or state waters, so we've got to work closely with them, and they're a big part of the oyster restoration efforts. We've got a number of other folks here, Fish and Wildlife, you see, Nature Conservancy. You're going to hear a little bit more from the Chesapeake Conservancy today and how they're supporting the habitat focus area efforts, and Midshore River Keepers, and of course the Chesapeake Bay Program. It's great to hear from Rich today because we're really interested in how we can connect what's happening in the Choptank to the larger Chesapeake Bay Program initiatives under the Bay Program Agreement. So the habitat focus area for the Choptank is centered around three primary objectives. The first is habitat conservation and restoration with a big focus on oysters, but we're also interested in fish habitat and trying to preserve the healthy fish habitat that's in the system. We're also trying to better integrate our science. And when I say our science, I mean NOAA science. NOAA's got a lot of satellite information. We've got the weather service. We've got people doing fish population studies. We're trying to figure out what's the best way to deliver that science to local decision makers here in the Choptank watershed to help them improve how they're trying to conserve and plan for the future in this system. And then lastly, but really important, is community engagement. We understand that all of you who live here have certain priorities. You have an idea in mind for how you want the Choptank to look in the future for your kids and others. And so we're interested in learning about what those priorities are and working with you, sort of looping back to the science, to provide products and information that can help you achieve those priorities in the system. And Joanna Ogburn is going to talk a little bit more today about those community engagement efforts. So just to set up some of the challenges here in the Choptank, many of you are probably well aware of this, but number one is oysters. It's the primary reason we came to this watershed. There were some opportunities because Maryland had selected three tributaries within the watershed to be sanctuaries. So we were interested in trying to improve oyster populations in those sanctuaries. Bay-wide, oysters are at less than 1% of historic abundance. What's really important to think about there too is when you fish out oysters, when you remove oysters, you're also removing their habitat. It's different from other fisheries where you can pull out fish, there's still a population in the water, they can sort of reproduce. Oysters really need that habitat to survive, and you're removing both the oyster and the habitat when they're removed. Also, we know that the system is changing. Growth is occurring, populations are growing, the face of the landscape is changing. We'll look at a map in a little bit, but you saw maps earlier. It's roughly 60% agricultural, but we know that that's shifting. You're getting more areas that are developed. Currently, the watershed is about 5% sort of urban development like this. We know from work at Maryland Department of Natural Resources with Jim Uphoff that once you start to get up to that above 5% impervious surface, you start to see declines in the ecological health, in fish in particular. So this is really important to try to think about, what this growth means for the health of the system. The other major challenge is climate change, specifically sea level rise. The Chesapeake Bay is second only to New Orleans in terms of projected sea level rise. So the Choptank is not immune to those changes. It's also going to be looking at significant sea level rise. This is actually a picture from 1910. This is Holland Island. Some of you may have seen this, a house on that island. This is what it looked like in 2014, and I believe it's now gone. But again, the Choptank is also going to be facing some significant sea level rise, and we need to think about what that means in terms of habitat and the communities that live there. So this slide is meant to talk a little bit more about NOAA's interest in the Choptank and linking that to some of the things we heard earlier today with respect to water quality and agriculture. On the right panel here, titled NOAA Interests or Activities, points out a couple of things. One, I've mentioned oysters as being the key reason we're here. These areas that are highlighted in purple are oyster sanctuaries, thanks to Maryland Department of Natural Resources setting those aside for ecological restoration purposes. That means there's no fishing in these tributaries. That's important. Broad Creek, right here, is actually open to fishing. Some of the other things to point out here are fish habitat. The Choptank is really important for striped bass spawning. It's one of the more important river systems in the Chesapeake for that. That's what you see. This area highlighted in sort of yellowish green here is a striped bass spawning habitat area within the Choptank. And then these areas in dark green is a herring and shad spawning habitat. So we're interested in trying to ensure that these remain healthy or even improve by working with those that are working on issues on land. And with respect to oysters, we certainly don't want water quality to degrade in this system in a way that we might lose all the effort that's been put into oyster restoration. And just to point out again, the land use in the system, predominantly agriculture, but there are developing, you know, urban areas, Easton, Cambridge, and up in Denton, that you know, we're interested in trying to link what's happening there to improving ecological health. So now I'm going to get into some more specifics on oyster restoration. So this is the Choptank River. You see Harris Creek, Tred Avon, and Little Choptank. Oyster restoration in Harris Creek had a target of 350 acres for restoration. That was completed last year in September of 2015. I'll talk a little bit about how that's looking right now in terms of success. Tred Avon has a target of 147 acres. Restoration has started there. We've been doing some of the reef construction, and seeding has been progressing this spring and summer, and will continue. So we're looking forward to seeing those restoration efforts continue. And then in the Little Choptank River, there's 440 acres that are targeted. We're well on our way in terms of 45 acres that are complete and 102 acres that are partially complete. So this is exciting. As far as we can tell, I mean, we've looked around. This is the largest oyster restoration anywhere in the nation and probably across the globe. The level of investment, as you probably heard, has been pretty high as well, about $44 million, I think, to date. That's obviously going to change. But the benefits of this restoration, we think, are going to be really valuable. So just talk about Harris Creek for a moment. I mentioned that the restoration was completed there in 2015, so we met that 350-acre target. This is what it looked like pre-restoration in terms of the orange reefs here are reefs that did not meet population levels that we've established as successfully restored or a healthy reef. Those levels are 15 oysters per square meter. What you see here in this panel are those same reefs, but they're now all green. And the green means that they have 15 oysters per square meter or more. And that means that 100% of the reefs are now meeting that success metric, the 15 oysters per square meter. And in fact, over 50% of those reefs actually have 50 oysters per square meter or more, which is really a higher end target that we're trying to achieve. We're also interested in what happens post-restoration. So we completed the oyster restoration in Harris Creek, and it looks like the populations are growing. That's a good thing, but what does it mean to fish? What does it mean to water quality? We know that oyster reefs are a really important habitat in the Chesapeake. So can we quantify that at this large-scale oyster restoration, we're also seeing changes in the system that are directly linked to it? So we've been conducting what we call Oyster Reef Ecosystem Services Study. That's focused in Tred, Avon, and Little Choptank. We're going out and collecting fish near the restored reefs and the different treatments of reefs, and trying to get a sense of, you know, are fish populations improving. And so we're still in the initial phases because we started this pre-restoration, so we had a really good baseline, and we're now into our third year of sampling. And if people are interested, we can certainly share more results. I just wanted to provide a high-level overview here. We're out there right now, actually, sampling. I'll mention while I'm on the slide, we've also are working with academic partners, University of Maryland and Virginia Institute of Marine Science. Lisa Kellogg and Jeff Cornwell are two of the primary researchers. They're doing some work in Harris Creek. They're looking at some of this fish utilization that I mentioned, but they're also looking at denitrification. We heard a little bit about that from Joel. So oysters and oyster reefs also provide denitrification. So the meaning taking nitrogen out of the system and releasing it as nitrogen gas, which takes the nitrogen, the sort of, what I want to say, the bad forms of nitrogen, changes them to something that becomes inert and leaves the system. So that's a really important role that oysters play, and we're trying to get better numbers around what that means. So also in Harris Creek, just linking the restoration to what we're seeing with respect to, in this case, water clarity or turbidity is actually what you're seeing up here. Oyster populations have, in fact, gone up, as I've talked about, since restoration started in 2011. You see this steep increase. There's been a little bit of a decline, but they're still much above where they were previous to restoration. And then in the yellow, we're also seeing water clarity. This is turbidity declining, so water clarity improving, coincident with the oyster restoration. This shows you the same, a little bit more information at a larger spatial scale, just indicating that we are seeing some of these water clarity improvements that I think Rich also talked to bay-wide, but within the system here, this is what it looks like. So, you know, as we heard, this system is, especially in these areas where you're talking about these creeks, I mean, the creeks are what's influencing that water clarity. And so we're seeing improvements in water clarity since 2013, where we see really steep increases in clarity, and that again is coincident with the oyster restoration. I'm not saying one has led to the other, because we are seeing these sort of trends at a much broader scale, but this is what we would expect. If you increase oyster populations, you would expect cleaner water, and you would expect some other ecological changes that I'll refer to in just a moment. So this is good news. Submerged aquatic vegetation was mentioned earlier. This is from the VIM survey. This is showing on the left panel 2010 and on the right 2015. This is, not oyster density, SAV density. And you can see pretty significant changes from 2010. Again, this is pre-restoration to post-oyster restoration. And we are seeing these changes system-wide. So it's hard to say directly that oysters are you know, leading to this, but you put oyster populations going up, you put SAV density going up, and you say water clarity is improving, that's a really good story. That's what we want to see. So how do we continue that trajectory? What's coming up next for the habitat focus area in the Choptank? A couple of things. Water column habitat, that's a term we like to use. What we're getting at there is some of the things I've talked about. So if we increase oyster populations, can we actually quantify, measure a change in water quality or clarity that's directly linked to those increases in oyster populations? So we're gonna be working with some researchers, some of those are in the room, to try to figure out what that study should look like, what sort of monitoring would be needed to do that. We've also got Tred Avon Ecological Assessment. Suzanne Skelly is the director of the Cooperative Oxford Lab in the back there. She's heading this up through her lab. What the idea here is to look at 8 areas within the Tred Avon with varying land use types, try to quantify the water quality at those different land use types, and also what the fish health or fish response is to those different land use types in the system. So again, just trying to make those linkages between what's happening on land, water quality, and then the ecological or fish response. And then the third is envision the Choptank, and you'll hear again more about this from Joanna Ogburn later today, but this is reaching out to the community, trying to better understand what the priorities are, also trying to figure out how we can better sort of target best management practices in the lower end of this watershed, below where Tom is doing some of his work, to ensure that, or try to ensure that water quality is improving in a way that will also help support the oyster restoration efforts that we talked about today. So that's it.
Data shows that the ag contributions are 50 to 60% of non-point pollution, yet ag only gets 6% of resources, while other sectors that contribute much less pollution receive the majority of resources. Why? I started off with a softball. I mean,
I'm going to let my state partners deal with that one. I think that's an excellent question. Not only in Maryland, but if you look across the watershed, we put billions of dollars into upgrading around 478 significant wastewater treatment facilities. It's been great. We're actually just essentially hitting our 2025 goal for wastewater just about now in terms of with Maryland, Virginia, and all the other states in the District of Columbia. So we humans find a way of raising billions of dollars to put concrete in place and to put clean water in the streams and stuff, but we only do a fraction of that into cost share for our producers. I like food, I like clean streams. I don't see the two being opposed to each other, but I think we have an opportunity not only in the Choptank but across this watershed to then say, given the funding streams we've got in at least four of the six states in the district out there, how do we transfer those that was for wastewater into the agricultural sector and the stormwater sector and try to maintain what I pay as a monthly fee for my wastewater treatment facility. Now that it's upgraded, I'd like to see it go on the western and eastern shores. But we haven't made that transition, but that's a great question, and I think something we need to have a Choptank-wide and a Chesapeake Bay watershed-wide discussion, how to maintain those funding streams that are already coming out of our monthly bills, and it's a lot less than my cable bill or my daughter's cell phone bill.
Okay. Dr. Fisher, if you looked at water quality trend lines for nitrogen, phosphorus, and dissolved oxygen starting in 2005, so 10 years ago, about, would the trend lines be opposite?
Whenever you shorten a water quality record, you reduce your ability to see changes over time. I think you might see no significant changes if you only look from 2005 to 2015, I don't think you would see a downward trend in those graphs that I showed. You would just see like a little scatter diagram because you need the earlier data to anchor the changes that have occurred over the last 25 years or so. So I think the answer to that is no. Just looking at the last 10 years would not clarify anything. It would probably make it harder to see examples of change. What I did not show in my, because of time limitations, was if you look at, for instance, chlorophyll A, the index of phytoplankton biomass in the estuary, it is very strongly related to how much river flow is present. So a sensitive indicator is, is that relationship changing? And for the last 2 years or so, the chlorophyll A values that we saw were significantly lower than you would expect based on the previous 25 years. And so that's, to me, that's saying there's some change occurring in the way that the nutrients are being delivered. So that's a whole different conversation, but I don't think that shortening the record would really change any of the conclusions, and it might muddy the water, so to speak, and make it harder to see statistically significant changes.
Yeah, fortunately, I have to agree with part of what Tom said, but some of the work that Dr. Rebecca Murphy from University of Maryland Center for Environmental Science at the Partnership Office is doing is actually looking at almost a 32-year record of in our tidal waters, then actually looking at a 10-year window. And there are times that you actually can see, like, water transparency. It was declining for decades, and then the last decade is showing what we saw up here as well, that we are actually seeing a sort of a halting of that, and it's actually starting to improve. So, Tom, you're right. Sometimes it's tougher to do that, but with the tools that we're now bringing our USGS partners and our university partners, we actually are able to look within those trends because things have been changing on that landscape that we need to make the connection to as well. So we haven't shown you that science. That's now sort of underway right now, but I think over the next year to 2 years, we'll be able to bring a clearer story for the Choptank.
Thank you. Joel, this one's for you. Regarding hotspots, the first part of the question is, were you making the point that the Choptank is one of the few or a limited number of hotspots across the entire Chesapeake Bay watershed for inputs of nitrogen and phosphorus? And if yes, the second part of the question is, what are the other hotspots?
Yes, I was making that. That's exactly the point I was making. And with respect to the Choptank, I was really referring to the entire eastern shore. And so for other regions that we see as hotspots, basically by looking at the respective models we've developed between inputs and observed loads, it's areas like the lower Susquehanna River watershed, the large agricultural valley that extends through Western Maryland and Virginia and West Virginia, that's the Shenandoah Valley system and the Conococheague watershed. And so we have this arcing system of developed agricultural watersheds with concurrent development pressures that extends all the way across Virginia, up through central Pennsylvania, and basically arcs down around Maryland's eastern shore.
If I could just add something to that. I think a simple way to look at this is that the sources of nutrients that come into Chesapeake Bay are from basically the production of our food and the disposal of our waste. And so when you have areas with large amounts of agriculture or large amounts of people, that's where the hotspots are. So it's the problems of water quality come from us, from our activities on land, the production of our food, and the disposal of the waste after we eat the food. And those are the big sources. And so if you look at big urban centers, or if you look at areas with high concentrations of agriculture, that's where the nitrogen and phosphorus is coming from.
I think too that we're, given what I showed you earlier, that we now have a 1 meter resolution land cover for the entire Chesapeake Bay watershed due to our Chesapeake Conservancy colleagues, et cetera. Oftentimes we paint these broad pictures of huge hotspots. We've got the tools now, let's not pick on the Eastern Shore, look at Lancaster, Pennsylvania. You know, we paint that as a red color up there. And in fact, they're doing, like they're doing on the shore, a lot of good work by our producers. We're getting smarter about not only at that big broad scale, where in fact within those watersheds, within those sub-watersheds, within those production areas, should we be focusing? So given the information we've got here, the tools that you heard from University of Maryland and USGS, we're getting smarter about focusing, not just painting broad pictures, but where on the landscape, where on those production areas, where in those counties do we need to in fact to go. So I think that's, again, one of the pictures we need to bring is not just a big red spot on the Choptank, but where exactly in the Choptank are we making progress and where do we need to focus our efforts?
We only have a few more minutes and we have many more questions up here, but hopefully we'll get to them. But I have another one for Mr. Blomquist, which I had as well when I was sitting listening to your presentation. What recommendations are you using to determine exactly what the crop needs for nitrogen and phosphorus? Have they been updated to reflect increased yield and nutrient use efficiency? Where does the 10 to 12 plus application above crop need estimation come from?
So,
again, another softball.
Well, actually, that's not really a softball for me because this is part of the process where I'm trying to reach out to those that are much more in touch with the agricultural community than I am to make sure that we're getting this information into our ag service agencies and our conservation agencies' hands and directly to the farm community so they understand that it's a balance between the implementation of management actions that are out to control the movement of nitrogen and phosphorus and actually adding less nitrogen and phosphorus to the soil. And in many cases, you know, that message has been heard in terms of the implementation, for example, of precision agriculture, which really is there to target the amount and the location specifically of those chemicals.
Okay. I'd like to add just one brief thing to that. I think most farmers, like Bobby Hutchinson, would probably object to the term excess fertilizer because farmers are small businessmen and they run their businesses based on the bottom line, and they don't apply excess phosphorus or nitrogen because they know what the yields are. They go by the land grant university recommendations, and when we've actually done this on a couple of farms where we've reduced how much nitrogen and phosphorus were applied, and the yields went down. So they're managing their farms based on the revenue, how much crop will they get back for the amount of fertilizer that they apply. The real issue, the part of the problem is that the way fertilizer is applied, it's often applied in batches at times when, so there's excess for brief periods of time, but the, you know, if you spread out that fertilizer application, you can actually get a higher use efficiency. Right now, nitrogen use efficiency on most farms is about 50%. So 50% of the nitrogen comes off as crop and the other half is left behind. So that's the room that we have for making fertilizer use more efficient and maybe getting the same yields with less fertilizer or getting improved yields with the amount of fertilizer that's being applied. I think you have to be careful with that, with the use of that term excess fertilizer, because I think farmers know what, how much is needed to grow a certain crop, and they're not deliberately applying excess from what I've seen from my interactions with the farmers like Bobby.
You're also fortunate to have folks like Jason, Lindsay, I saw earlier as a part of the partnership's agricultural work group. They're looking at an expert panel taking a look at the sort of the next generation of nutrient management techniques and what the efficiencies are on that, as well as the land-grant universities, which are different across the six-state watershed. That information is being built into the partnership's Phase 6 watershed model I described, which I think we're going to take our simulation of agricultural lands, again, which are different even on the Delmarva, much less up in New York or out in West Virginia, light years ahead of what we've got out there as well, to get a better sense of what's applied out there, but also a better record of the past 30 years and the practices on there. So that's a good point. I think we throw up these earlier statistics. Our science has evolved much more, even in the last 5 years, that we need to factor that into our tools.